stand up for your right. Get up, stand up. Stand up for your right.
Alafia. This is Nkechi Taifa, civil and human rights attorney, scholar activist, freedom fighter, and bestseller author. Welcome to Human Rights and Justice, my new talk show featuring kick-ass commentary and stimulating guests. We discuss domestic and global themes, highlighting political, economic, and social rights. Get up and stand up with me, Nkechi Taifa, for human rights and justice.
We declare our right on this earth to be a man, to be a human being, to be respected as a human being, to be given the rights of a human being in this society, on this earth, in this day, which we intend to bring into existence by any means necessary.
Yeah, we're going to bring it into existence by any means necessary. Welcome to the 14th episode of Human Rights and Justice. All episodes can be heard or viewed on WPFWFM radio archives on Nkechi Taifa's YouTube channel, website, NkechiTaifa.com, and available wherever you get your podcasts. Oh my God, I'm so excited. Today, we are going to have a powerful, power-packed evening discussing the UN Permanent Forum on People of African Descent. Okay, we're going to talk about that. Black women advancing reparations in Geneva. We're going to be talking about the situation dealing with the GU-272 and the relationship between that and what's happening internationally. We're going to be talking with Dr. Amara Enyia. We're going to be talking with Dr. Vickie Casanova-Willis. We're going to be talking with Angela Proctor. We're going to be talking with Dr. Don Mellon Patton and Mrs. Rochelle Praetor. And I'll be introducing them more fully after we do our Black Facts, because, you know, we start off every episode of Human Rights and Justice with Black Facts, facts that occurred this week in different years throughout history, called from the Black Seeds calendar and Brian Stevenson's Equal Justice Institute calendar. Y'all ready? Okay, let's go. December, let's look at December this week, starting with the 4th. Oh my goodness, I can do this from memory. Black Panthers, Fred Hampton, Mark Clark assassinated in their beds in Chicago by Chicago police, 1969. We will never, ever, ever forget. That's the 4th of December in 1969. On the 5th of December in 1935, educator Mary McLeod Bethune founded National Council of Negro Women in 1935. On December the 10th in the year 1956, the Popular Movement for the Liberation of Angola, MPLA, was established. Also on the 10th, in the year 1964, Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. wins the Nobel Peace Prize, and Dr. Wangari Maathai of Kenya was presented the Nobel Peace Prize in 2004 for her social and environmental work and her work for democracy and peace. That was from the Black Seeds calendar and Brian Stevenson's Equal Justice Institute calendar. Of course, he also includes Black Panther leaders Fred Hampton, Mark Clark assassinated, pre-dawn apartment raid, four more party members were wounded. December 5th in 1910, Lord, listen to this, y'all. A judge in Washington, D.C. rules that 8-year-old Isabel Wall cannot attend a segregated school for white students because she's 1/16th Black. You know, they talk about one drop. Well, that's what she had. On December 6th in the year 1915, in the case McKenzie versus Hare, U.S. Supreme Court upholds a federal statute stripping women of their U.S. citizenship if they marry, quote unquote, foreigners. Anyway, December 7th, 1874, after a formerly enslaved man is elected sheriff in Vicksburg, Mississippi, white people remove him and kill Black citizens who tried to reinstate him. And then he's later shot in the head by a white deputy. December 8th, the year 1915, a Black woman named Cordelia Stevenson is lynched near Columbus, Mississippi. After being wrongfully accused of burning a white man's barn, her body is left hanging for 2 days. On December 9th in the year 2014, U.S. government releases report on CIA torture of Muslim detainees from 2001 to 2006, including force feeding, mock executions, physical and sexual violence, sleep deprivation, and waterboarding. And finally, on December 10th in the year 1960, while in Florida for a bowl game, Black players on an integrated California college football team are banned from lodging with teammates in segregated hotel. That was in 1960. So those were our Black facts for now. And, you know, I'm so glad what's going on in Geneva right now, because we're finally beginning to get some international attention to what is happening. I'm going to introduce our guests that we have, and there will be another guest joining us as well. But we have with us Dr. Vickie Casanova-Willis, my sister, Sally. Also, it's late for you there, because I know you're in Geneva, Switzerland right now, and it's after 11 o'clock p.m. So hats off to you for joining Human Rights and Justice. Vickie is advocating for human rights, global and local change. She was sent by the Office of the High Commissioner for Human Rights as a delegate to the historic first session of the Permanent Forum on People of African Descent. Vickie is co-chair of the Communications IT Subcommittee for the International Civil Society Working Group, is the executive assistant and special consultant for OHBCUD, the Office of HBCU Development International Cooperation, and IFRAM, the International Association of American Minorities. Welcome, Vickie.
Thank you, thank you, thank you. Can you hear me okay?
I can hear you fine. I'm going to introduce the other folk who are on the screen.
Wonderful.
Right, we're going to get into it. We also have Angela Proctor, who is the head university archivist and digital librarian for Southern University and A&M College in Baton Rouge, Louisiana. Angela was lead researcher interviewing descendants of nearly 300 enslaved Africans sold into the sugarcane plantation system by the Jesuits to do what? To save Georgetown University from bankruptcy. Her work on the GU 272 to Southern U Memory Project recently created a digital archive and database that documents the life stories and history of descendants who have a connection to Southern University, the only historical lead Black college university system in the U.S. And we have with us, and she spoke with us, two of the descendants of the GU 272, Dr. Dawn Mellon Patton and Mrs. Rochelle Praetor. So welcome, everybody. Before we go on and get into the GU 272, I just want to say that in permanent form on people of African descent, it's going on right here, right now, in Geneva. Vickie, can you just tell us just what this forum is? And then after you explain what this is, I see that Amara has joined us from Geneva, but let us know just what the permanent forum is, what its significance is to us here in the United States and Blacks throughout the diaspora.
Excellent, excellent question. So nothing happens quickly in the human rights arena. And the interesting thing is that more than 20 years ago, some people know about the World Conference on Racism in Durban, South Africa, when there was finally, in large part due to work that extremely conscious lawyers like yourself, Sis Nkechi Taifa and others in CBL and so forth, as well as human rights educators, people who were directly impacted peoples like these GU 272 descendants, but on whom it depends to be able to tell the stories of the history, that whole Sankofa process, to ensure that we are receiving the full rights that we are entitled to, as opposed to just moving through from a human rights standpoint or civil rights standpoint. So to be clear, the human rights framework is something that people have thought about as, well, that's just international. You go to the UN, it's over in Geneva, Switzerland. It has nothing really to do with people in their homes and their cities around the world. And that's not the case. So the long story short is that one of the things that was declared through all that work more than 20 years ago was that part of the Durban Conference and declared that the transatlantic slave trade was indeed a crime against humanity. The second part
should have been such.
And thank you. Always should have been such. Yep. And the second part that was being lobbied around, and my husband was a part of that, one of your colleagues, one of your one of, yeah. And that it was also to be designated that in the human rights framework, any harm to people, individuals, or groups, the remedy is repair, full reparation, right? It's not just financial. It's not that 40 acres and a mule. So that's the connection, is that one of the things that was determined was they did not get in. Some of the folks were a little nervous about saying that reparations, because they're complicit and it's a lot of money. And what's important about the GU 272, for example, is that we have to tell our stories, because it verifies for our conversations at the UN and then bringing those decisions back home. It verifies that, yes, this did meet the measure that requires reparation. You can't do this to people. From a human standpoint, you just can't. And it didn't just happen back then. It affects these folks right now, for whom that was a part of the legacy. So the important thing is that 20 years ago, they called for an international decade. They called for a permanent forum on people of African descent. They called for all these mechanisms, and people have been advocating since then. And finally, 20 years later, more than 20, this week was the opening session and 4 days sitting with a range of African people of African ancestry all around the world to bring these both celebrating, but also recognizing that this is the start to do the hard work to bring about full reparation and a new way forward to respect human rights. That's it.
So, Vickie, thank you so very much for that background. I see that Amara has joined us. I want to go on and introduce her, and we can just get into a full-fledged conversation. How are you, my sister, Dr. Amara Enyia? I don't never know if I know the right way to pronounce it.
Enyia.
She is in Geneva right now, and it is almost midnight over there. So I really appreciate you and Vickie joining from Geneva, as well as our colleagues who are here. But Dr. Amara is chair of the International Civil Society Working Group for the Permanent Forum of People on people of African Descent, president of Transnational Advocacy Organization Global Black, and manager of policy and research for the Movement for Black Lives. Dr. Amara's strategy and her policy work connects her to the sixth region of the African Union Commission, and she is a member of the 2001-2002 cohort with the London School of Economics Executive Program in Cities. Welcome, my sister. And let me just tell y'all, I spent the afternoon listening to the back videos, I guess you could say, from Monday and Tuesday from the forum. And I saw a lot of my friends. I saw y'all, Vickie, I heard your testimony. I saw Dr. Breen Shepherd. Of course, our dear Justin Hansford. I saw Robin Blue out there in the audience. I saw a glimpse of Gay McDougal. I said, oh, yeah, that's what I'm talking about. So Dr. Amara, Dr. Vickie has just given us a little bit of a background. Every time I heard the word reparations come up, I heard some chapping, clapping, and some cheers and all like that. I just want to know what your perspective of the last couple of days so far have been with respect to the forum. And I also have a question for both of you all there in Geneva. I kept hearing there's some issue dealing with language and Portuguese and not having provision for translators so that people could hear and understand what was going on. So if you could kind of touch on that as well.
Yeah, absolutely. First, it's so good to be in touch and to be able to share space with you. Just because, as Dr. Vickie said, all of the work that you've done in this space and in so many spaces. So it's really just kind of building on that. I think what sticks out to me, at least over the last couple of days, is that the energy is really high and there's a sense of optimism with people who are here. I think, you know, because this is it's been such a long road to get to this point, and definitely 2020 shook some things loose on a number of fronts. And so we saw kind of the acceleration of these processes and this advocacy work really in the last couple of years. But what's really interesting to say, and it's just on the point that you brought up, is the fact that just a few years ago, you wouldn't have heard the R word or read it in spaces like where we're seeing it now. And what really stood out in the first day, especially in the opening ceremony, the opening session, it's the word du jour, reparations, reparatory justice. It's over and over and over again. It is a premier topic area that everyone is trying to speak to, address, unpack, et cetera. And I think that's huge. And it speaks to the work of all those who've been in these spaces when people weren't listening or when it was taboo, a taboo topic. All of that, I think, is paying dividends. We are witnessing the previous years of work from our community to get to this point. And the fact that the energy is high and it is a space for us to see each other across the continent and diaspora. Because if we're talking about relationship building and working collectively and developing collective strategy, the first thing we have to do is see each other, to be in relationship with each other, to then start to work together. And that's, I think, a significant aspect of just the gathering, the fact of gathering ourselves in this way. On the issue of language justice, it's huge. Because this is a permanent forum on people of African descent, we know that our people are all over the world. We know that we speak our own languages, right? Our indigenous languages. And then we also speak these colonial languages, English, Spanish, French, Portuguese. And so it became clear that the investment to ensure that we can actually communicate with each other was not sufficient. We can't leave out entire groups of people. So oftentimes, like the Portuguese issue, with Brazil having a huge Black population in South America, millions and millions of Portuguese speakers, how can it not be included? Why would we not have translation? It actually doesn't make sense. And so that was something that they had to fight for and were able to get a Portuguese interpreter at a late stage. But this should be for every gathering where it's people of African descent. We have to represent the broad swath of our people. And that means Spanish speakers, Portuguese speakers, obviously English, French, but also even, you know, we should be thinking about our other languages, Swahili. Like, there are other languages that when we talk about people of African descent, we have to be inclusive in that way and we have to be intentional about it. And so the experience so far has just shown how much we have to push even for a multilateral international entity to actually represent that in the supports and the tools that we have at our disposal to make sure that we can do what we came here to do.
So thank you for that. Vickie, can you speak to that? Some change happened just a couple of weeks ago with respect to the title of the permanent forum, an issue about people or on people. Can you kind of share that, what that was all about?
It did, and it's so interesting. We have to be, you know, words matter. That's one of the comments that we've made today. And I'm just gonna remind us to, you know, to just not assume that this is a superficial exercise. It's really, really not. So initially when the conversation was happening, and you'll even see some of the official documents from on the UN website and, you know, Google, it was at one point the permanent forum, let's see, for people of African descent officially, then it changed to the permanent forum of people of African descent. And it was interesting because there was a little controversy that one of the initial 10 members happens not to be a person of African ancestry. And there's honest, this is my personal perspective. I'm not speaking now on the record as a member of the International Civil Society Working Group for the Permanent Forum of people of African descent. And I'm saying of because that now is the official language and it was changed.
Okay, so I think you froze up.
One little word. And so, yeah, it's just, so the question is why in a UN General Assembly, for example, would you literally take the time for member states, nations all around the world to debate something like that in these hours of conversation, a one letter change from of to on. Mm-hmm. So I'll stop there, but there's significance. And this actually to me links to GU 272 because it underscores the importance of agency for directly impacted peoples. If this is the permanent forum coming out of the Durban Declaration, like we talked about with the history, which finally recognizes and affirms, as you added, that this is a crime against humanity and always should have been recognized as such. Like, how can you even argue the enslavement, the Holocaust of African enslavement and so forth? I'll stop there, but that's the answer.
This was a good way to bring Angela and our GU 272 descendants into this conversation. Angela, can you just briefly tell us just what this memory project is and introduce the sisters that are part of that very critical archival project that you are engineering.
Sure. So our project initially started in September of 2021. We applied for a grant through the Social Science Research Council that required us to, or I should say the stipulations were, we interviewed descendants, but just not only GU 272 descendants. These descendants would also have ties to Southern University. So if you conduct a lot of your research, you would find that a lot of the persons that were shipped off to the various plantations to Louisiana, most of those persons were also graduates of Southern University. So that is the connection between the GU 272 and Southern University. And so with our project, we interview the persons that we have that are descendants, and they actually tell their stories. We had specific questions, but each person's story is going to be totally different. We just open the floor and let everyone talk and feel free to be able to say what they wanted to say, but also be mindful of what their family relationships were and what their families had to endure during those time periods. And so from that, we were able to create our archival database. And so persons can log on to our site and you can listen to all the videos from each of the various persons that we interviewed. And for the purpose of this interview, I solicited two of our persons that are with us today. I have first Dr. Don Million Patan, and the second person is going to be Mrs. Rochelle Prater. And so I will now turn it over to those two persons and I will let them talk.
All right. Okay, let's hear from some directly impacted people, direct descendants of the transatlantic slave trade and the plantation system and the whole Ma'afa, the Holocaust of enslavement. So who's going to start? Don, would you like to start?
Rochelle, would you like to start? You have more direct history.
Unmute yourself, Rochelle. Yes.
Okay, right. I'll be happy. Thank you, Don, for so graciously allowing me to come through. Thank you, ladies, for the work that you're doing. This is news to me. However, I'm very excited that this work has been elevated to the world stage on the level of the UN. I've done a lot of research myself with the UN, and I've always said a lot of the things that we tend to protest against in this nation, we've not heard. And I think that maybe if we enlisted the UN as an ally, we might actually be able to get somebody to at least hear what we're trying to say. So kudos to you ladies who are doing that work. I my work with the GU272 began in April of 2016 when the article broke in the New York Times of cousin Maxine Crump. I too was born and raised in Maryland, Louisiana. I knew immediately when I saw cousin Maxine in the article. I now live in Cincinnati and I was traveling at that time. I knew that she was related to me as a Crump. I did not know the Hawkins connection. And so I did discover that. But I can tell you that for me, when this news broke, I immediately got pen and paper and wrote down exactly what I felt I would want to happen, because this was a reality for me. So this wasn't a hypothetical. I knew at the time that my great-grandfather, Jackson Hawkins, was 3 years old when the sale was made. And my emotions was all over the place. And it was all over the place because if someone was to say, Rochelle, I got the checkbook, what do you want me to write it out for? I honestly could not bring myself to a dollar amount because it's not about a dollar amount for me. It was more about an investment, if you will, and not just me personally, but now I finally have that next layer of my generation. I have a granddaughter now. And so I know that if someone was to write Rochelle a check personally, Rochelle alone could not do very much collectively for the good of all, right? And so I have wrote down some specific things, you know, career and college and career empowerment, investment in mental health, investment in housing, investment in health, investment in, honestly, for me, from the heart, in reconciliation and understanding true, authentic reconciliation. I've been down the road of a lot of different times. Every century is something new. Diversity, cultural diversity, this, that, it's a buzzword. But I know for my little granddaughter in the bed in there that things have to change for her to be safe. Let's just ask Tyler Perry and Oprah Winfrey, who got the means to do whatever they want. If they walk out into the street, do they find themselves feeling respected and loved in a country that they were forced to be brought into? So those were my issues regarding that. Since that time of learning about all of this, I was telling someone today that it's beyond the certain items. I know, you know, like 9-year-old Adelphi West. I know that she was 9. I know her mother ran away. I know names. And I imagine what it was like in Louisiana, right? To be, I know going to Louisiana to visit is horrible sometimes. I'm not going to lie. The mosquitoes, the Johnson grass, the red ants. And when I think of those people, although they were enslaved in Maryland, true enough, that was what they were new, and that was their community, and that was their family. And they were torn away and taken to this foreign place. So I now have embodied the spirit of what it must have been like for them. I can't lay in bed at night and not think about what this one must experience or what that one must experience.
Yeah.
And that's why education is so much. And that's why when Angela asked, I think I saw it posted somewhere, and I reached out to Angela about this connection. And some one thing Angela didn't mention, one of the founders, original founders, and the first dean of students was John Sebastian Jones. He was the grandson of Henrietta Hill. So the history continues on and on that these people understood. I believe they knew that they were sold to keep an institution open and educated white people, mm-hmm. that it was their heart's desire to create institutions for us, even mm-hmm. on a higher level, but even Neely Hawkins with the broken headstone, he actually opened a school for colored kids on West Oak Lane. So it's powerful.
It is definitely powerful. And were you saying that your ancestor was the grandfather of, were you saying grandfather?
So
he was one of the two.
He was the John Sebastian Jones, who was the first dean of students and one of the founders of Southern University when it was in New Orleans.
Right.
His grandmother was Henrietta Hill.
Yes.
Not a direct link to me, but she was in that number. She was taken to Ascension Parish.
I got you.
But like I tell people, let me be clear. I have to say this for everybody here listening. I tend to not get strung out on these white folks' surnames because at the end of the day, we came from the motherland.
Thank you.
However, for the purposes of discussion, okay, we will discuss that. But I'm not going to debate with people about being a Hawkins or a Sanders or whatever, because that's not who I am.
Yes.
That's not who I was. That's not who I am. But for the purposes of leading back, the stepping stones back to Africa, it's a necessary discussion.
So I want to go on and bring Don Million into this discussion with the GU272, and then we're going to get back to Geneva. So tell us, Don, what your connection with all of this is.
Well, I was not familiar with any of this. I've been subscribing to Ancestry.com since 2011. And let me pause to thank you for the work that you're doing. As I've heard you talk, I have written down so many things to Google once we are off the call. But I discovered my connection to the GU272 through DNA testing I did in Ancestry.com. And I knew names, but I didn't have a connection. But before I get into the names I knew, I got 2 degrees from Southern, undergrad and master's. I got my PhD from Iowa State. I retired from Southern. I was an administrator, my last position in January of 2021. And in the summer of 1997, I had an opportunity to be a fellow with USDA in Washington, D.C. And while I lived in Washington, D.C., I walked the campus of Georgetown. And I didn't know anything about the connection, but I'm a poor girl from Iberville Parish. Mm-hmm. I'm going to say it again. I'm a poor girl from Iberville Parish with big dreams. Mm-hmm. So I walked that campus. And as I walked that campus and I looked at the trees and I looked at the flowers, and it's a beautiful manicured campus, I said stuff to myself, wow, I wish I could have gone here. Mm-hmm. I wish I could have gone here. Mm-hmm. It's not a public school, which means it costs a lot more than my Southern University, my Iowa State public, education. I wish I could have gone to Georgetown. Mm-hmm. That meant something to me. And to find out that my ancestors mm-hmm. were literally mm-hmm. stolen, mm-hmm. keep that school alive. I wish I could have a conversation, because I would tell the forces that be at Georgetown, at a bare minimum, what you need to do. And excuse me if you see the attitude, I'm very passionate about this. What they need to do as a minimum, I wrote through Maringouin as recently as 2 months ago. We need to have a huge community center in Maringouin. Mm-hmm. And I'm talking about a huge state-of-the-art community center where every child in that parish can go for the summer mm-hmm. for recreational activities, can go after school for tutoring. Georgetown is a world-ranked educational institution. They should be making some real investments. Mm-hmm. Up until earlier this year, I was not a fan of reparations. Mm-hmm. I did not think that reparations would solve the problem, some of the issues that we have. However, I read an article earlier this year And it was about the Spanish land grants that were given to people before, you know, the French took over. And I realized, and in this article, the descendants of those families that received the Spanish land grant in East Feliciana, West Feliciana Parish, the land was still worth millions. And you know what I realized? I could work five lifetimes. And I would not be able to pass that type of wealth on to my son.
Like everybody else got redressed but us. I saw something that that the descendants of 11 Italian lynching victims in New Orleans received cash payments from the U.S. government. This was in the late 1800s. You know how many Black folk have been lynched? Did anybody, you know what I mean? But before I want you to finish out, and I want to bring it back to Geneva.
So I just think that being a descendant has changed the way that I look. I knew that I was a descendant of slaves. I knew that. I just assumed that I were, that I was.
Africans who were enslaved in the United States.
Thank you for that correction.
We go back before slavery time.
No, thank you for that correction. Thank you for that correction. But I knew that I was the descendant of formerly enslaved persons.
Yeah.
However, to put a name to them, to know, to see the slave manifest and know, I think my fifth great grandfather, Basil, walked the land. I went to the cemetery and found his grave and his wife, Ellen Harris's grave. Can you imagine what that does to a person? For me, it gave me that extra superpower. Now I know where I come from. I know what my people have endured. So that told me I can stand up to anything.
Yes, indeed. Yes.
I am prepared. I'm literally prepared to conquer the world.
I like my sister. Remember? And that's what we're in the process of doing right now. The world's attention. African people now, the African diaspora, have the intention, the attention of the world going on right now in Geneva, Switzerland. And it seems as if Black women are the ones taking the lead in advancing that. And I just want to bring it back to Amara and Vickie right now, because I know I saw just the little snippets that I saw a lot of Black women that I love and near and dear to me that I know were over there. So give us some more flavor about reparations, what's happening there, connecting the issues that are here, such as GU 272, policing and things along those lines, to bringing it to the world attention in Geneva. Amara, do you want to jump in here?
Sure. So I will say it was amazing having one, the president of the permanent forum, current chair, is Epsi Campbell Barr, who is the former vice president, Black woman, of Costa Rica. We also had at the opening Francia Marquez, who just became vice president of Colombia. And she actually was one of the opening speakers for the opening ceremonies and attended some events that were just talking to each other. We were just in close space, having conversations about what the work looks like, how we work together, how we collaborate. That was very, it was just a really, it was something to see and something to experience. So, I mean, you're seeing in many of these key roles, you're seeing women from around the world, Black women, women of African descent that are in leadership, that are really taking up the space that they need to take up, and just carrying things in a way that is advancing the cause. And that has been phenomenal to see. And it's grassroots. I mean, so many people that come from grassroots organizations who are doing work in their local communities. And to have grassroots folks and then vice presidents of countries all in the same space, on the same level, just talking to each other and fellowshipping with each other has been a really, really a wonderful experience. And it just reinforces what we're doing. And it creates a community that where we know we have each other's backs. And I think that's so important in this work, because it's difficult work, but to be able to fellowship with each other, to build relationships and to know that we have each other's back, it just makes this journey so much richer. So I can definitely say that about how Black women are showing up.
So Vickie, can you explain a little bit about the structure? I mean, I know I heard your testimony. I think it was called an intervention. What the interventions were from civil society organizations versus whatever it was from the official representative. Can you tell us a little bit about how it is structured?
Definitely. So, you know, just think about going to a conference, right? Because really at the simplest level, this is just a big conference. It's on human rights. It's on the United Nations. You all can Google. There's multiple massive numbers of different offices. There are all these NGOs we've all heard of, you know, the Human Rights Council. Many people don't know there's the office of OHCHR. So there's also all these acronyms. It's actually another language that we all need to become really proficient in. So I keep coming back to the OHBCUD, Office of HBCU Development, is why I'm also in this work to help leverage these. It's really over 400 historically Black colleges and universities and PBIs, predominantly Black institutions, that have scholars and digital archivists and librarians. I didn't even know that existed until Angela said that this is something that they were working on. And so I'm starting there to say that when all of the various mechanisms, they call them, within the human rights framework are either working on, they call it their mandate, which is like their marching orders or their, you know, their assignment, their job description. Some focus very specifically on things like the CAT, the Convention Against Torture, which, as you know, lots of work was done to finally deal with things like police torture, even in Chicago, right? And so there are treaties to, in fact, coming up not too long from now, there are treaties that require reviews at certain times for every state or nation. They call them states, but it's the nation states, right? Every country that is a part of the United Nations. The United Nations is hundreds of nations that, starting in 1948, coming out of really the initial Holocaust that was recognized, right, was after World War II, when all of a sudden the world decided we need to stop acting like what happens across that border is not my business, because now we realize that if it, you know, it could affect the world. And yes, I am my brother's and sister's keeper. And so that's really the impetus of this. And there's all kinds of, can you hear me okay? There are all kinds of forums and treaties, and this is a permanent forum. Instead of us going every 4 years when it finally becomes the time for, let's say, the U.S. to be reviewed on the status CSW, Convention on the Status of Women and Girls, or, you know, what's the circumstances for people of African descent or African ancestry. Now there is a permanent forum, meaning that any given time there's an agenda, and that's the focus, to advocate around those things. You come, you participate, and you testify for 2 minutes.
Right. Right. But yeah, you got get your points across, and it was very profound. I just want to make sure that the listening public knows we're listening to Human Rights and Justice, WPFWFM. If you want to call in, you can dial 202-588-0893. We're talking about the UN Permanent Forum of People of African Descent, and we're talking about the GU-272. Black Women Advancing Reparations in Geneva. We're talking about the issue of reparations. I know Robin Ruth Simmons is there from Evanston, the first jurisdiction to use a creative funding source to fund reparation projects. I know you're there from Chicago, the torture, which your husband helped to bring to a fore, the police torture and the reparations ordinance that was passed by the city of of Chicago. I know that Justin Hansford and Billy Wilkinson from the Thurgood Marshall Civil Rights Clinic at Center at Howard University, the African American Redress Network are there. And I know that the issue of the 272 is coming up. So let me go back to Amara. What's the future? What's coming up? There's several more days, I think, of the permanent forum. What else are we going to be seeing? And also, I'm just curious, what's happening to CERD? Not CERD, IPAD, the International Decade for People of African Descent. We're near the end of that. What's
and
the relationship
CERD, you're right.
between that and the permanent forum?
Yeah, so the forum actually tomorrow, Thursday, is the last day. So it's 4 days. So it's been an intense 4 days of sessions and side events. And so what we're, you know, I think a lot of us are processing what this experience has been and also taking note on what this experience has been, because we are concerned not just with the content, like we know the content that needs to be there just from the work that we do, but we're also concerned with the structure. What is it, how do we make this actually work in our interests? How do we make this a mechanism that serves our purposes, that helps us to advance our agenda? I think it's pretty clear that people aren't just going to Geneva because they want to go to Geneva, right? If I wanted a vacation, I'd go somewhere warmer than Geneva. Exactly. So we want to make this useful. And so with that, we are downloading the information, processing it, developing recommendations based on our observations. And those recommendations will be both for the UN, for the PFAB members, but also as we go back as a working group and begin to unpack how this has played out and what actually we need. Everything from how do you engage civil society? How do people get heard beyond, you know, so they're not just a rushed 2-minute statement, right? Like, how do we make this a meaningful space for us? I mean, even in the cultural representation, we pushed really hard to make sure that there was some sort of cultural opening ceremony, because as people of African descent coming together, we can't just do this like everyone else does it. So even those details are, you know, there's been a lot of thought put behind it. So it also can serve, we want it to serve as a cohering mechanism for like CERD, right? Like with the international decade, of which this was a key part of the decade. So there's talk now of how we make the last couple of years meaningful. And also there's even talk of extending the decade. That's a conversation that's come up, because for the first majority of the decade, the energy and the resources and the support is really gained in the last couple of years, I think. And so now it's, do we extend the decade? And then how do we make at least the last 2 years of this particular decade meaningful? And so I think there's an energy around that now that is good to see. I think there's an energy around commemorating the decade, making advancing the progress that we've seen, and hopefully having the permanent forum as a cohering mechanism that can bring in alignment all of the other mechanisms that we have.
So let me just go back to Dawn and to Miss Dawn and Miss Rochelle right now. You know, I mean, you're hearing what's happening globally right now. You're involved domestically here in the United States. How do you think that your voices can be elevated even more so that it's not just isolated here to this country or to what the Jesuits or Georgetown will or will not do, but that there's a larger forum out there that you can also appeal to and hold these entities accountable to? I don't know if you have any thoughts or views along those lines.
I actually do.
Okay, yes, Ms.
Rochelle. I actually do because, you know, one of the things was the creation of the foundation, the Descendants Foundation, that was designed or said that it would have $1 billion endowment with perpetuity for 100 years. However, what ended up happening was, yes, it was agreed to, but okay, we got to raise the money. So there's been some discussions about the slow movement. And now it's to the point where there's pressure being put on the local, the U.S. and Canadian Jesuit conference to put pressure on the Vatican, on Rome.
Yes, yes.
To fund that, because it should be something like, ask them for the money to fund this, because this, again, is about having a fund where it's an investment in an investment fund so that the programming and service to benefit the descendants can be done based upon the interest generated by that investment.
And so actually, because, I know that there was a presentment to Rome. Amara, I don't know if you want to elaborate on that, but
I believe this passed with the frustration and the slow movement. You know, Joe Stewart did write a letter to Rome and to, I guess it's the Sergeant General, for, you know, doing something, because they did something in Canada, with the what happened with the Native Americans. However, I do want to add, I do want to share with everybody for consideration. There was a, if you don't mind, if I have time.
Yeah, no, I just say quickly, because we have a.
Okay, quickly. Okay. Okay, so basically, apparently there was some monetary things like a settlement that had happened with them. I think it was like $50,000 per person. There was an event that occurred at Georgetown not so long ago, and someone was in attendance in there, and one of the Native American recipients of that community said that they wish they had thought about doing something like an investment type thing versus a direct payment, because many of the members of that community are still in worse shape. I think they got like $50,000 per person that was named in that settlement or whatever. And so there's been some issues with, because the people, for whatever reasons, now that it's been signed and it's done, the deal is over with.
So you, what you're saying basically is that you can learn from that experience, is what
exactly.
You're saying, right?
Exactly. It's got to be investments.
And Amara, I know that there was a presentment to the Vatican with a delegation that I think you were part of, with Cam Howard and other folk, and Nicole Hannah-Jones and the like. I don't know if you want to say something very briefly about that, as it ties into what Ms. Rochelle is talking about.
Yeah, so absolutely. So we did, the presentment was drafted, and it lays out the crime, the harm, the remedy of the role of the Catholic Church in as an initiators of the transatlantic slave trade, of essentially blessing the transatlantic slave trade and the dehumanization of Black people. So there was a delegation that did go to the Vatican this July. You mentioned some of the names, Dr. Ron Daniels, Cam Howard, Nicole Hannah-Jones, and a few others, as well as some Black Italians and other Black people from around Europe that we had invited to join us in that, and did meet with the Holy See. For those who are familiar, the Vatican has it's a vast administration. It's almost like a government. And so we were able to meet with people in leadership, present the presentment, and invite them to this journey of reparative justice and what it should look like. And it was actually a very productive meeting. I think it was important for us to be clear, and important for them to hear that perspective. And I think it feeds into some of the other work that's also happening around the Catholic Church and just these other religious institutions, even, you know, the Anglican, there's some other things going on as well. And so it was a good, I think it's an important part of ongoing work on many aspects of what reparations should look like.
So thank you so much for that. Dawn, if you can just very, very briefly give your reflection on that. We only have a couple of more minutes, and I just want to have Vickie close out, but I'm really glad that Angela Proctor brought Dawn Million okay, and Rochelle Sanders Prater to this conversation, because it's always critical to have directly impacted people as well. So Dawn, do you have very briefly?
Very briefly, I agree with Rochelle. And there needs to be some investment. And I think one of the best places is in Iberville Parish, and then have it trickle out from there, because Iberville, Ascension, and the other parish. That's where the majority of the enslaved people were transferred to. So I think there needs to be some huge community investments to include educational benefits for the descendants.
Okay, thank you so very much. And Dr. Vickie, give us some of your, any of your concluding thoughts or observations that you might have.
I will tell you, so really quickly, if I can, that I'm, what I'll do is just share with you a little bit of what I was able to rush through. And when Dr. Amara said 2 minutes, literally you have to be very clear, very succinct, very focused, because there are hundreds of people in the room who are trying to help inform with their testimony, their interventions, whatever's on the agenda for that couple of hours. And so for this very first session, historic, very first session of this very permanent form, the first one for people on people of African descent, their part of their agenda is developing a declaration for the rights of African descendants or people of African ancestry. So how heavy is that, right? The member group is 10 people, and they're trying to get as much, it's called civil society, that's us, directly impacted people. So what I'm heartened by is that not everybody can get on a plane and go to Geneva. I've been doing this work for 20 years, following my husband, very deeply involved. But this is the first time I've ever been to the UN to participate live, because we've been able to participate through writing stakeholder reports, doing the research, interviewing people, helping facilitate press releases and so forth. So the word can be spread. But the bottom line is that today, for example, an honorable minister, you know, came from Barbados and talked about his testimony was the sugar plantations in Barbados, which were the very first place that Britain got its wealth by sending his African descendants there to season them. And, you know, so I heard in that that Queen Sugar in Louisiana. These GU-272, no, I'm talking about King Cotton. People know about that, but the GU-272 were sold down the river, like we heard, into the sugarcane plantations. That same footprint is now Cancer Alley. So they're no longer enslaved, but it's the same game. So the legacy continues. And we thank you for helping spread this word, Sis Nkechi, because you are back in D.C., spreading the word internationally. This radio program, their archives that are done at Southern University, can be part of the testimony to help these experts and everybody else be able to hear, because they're developing declarations. I'm done.
We got to wrap up. So thank you very much. And thank you to our guests. Thank you for listening to episode 14, Human Rights and Justice. Thank you to our listeners. Thank you to our podcast partners. Thank you all. Love you all.
Thank you.
Stand up for your rights.